Hey, what's good? We are back. Another episode of the Paul Pika Podcast, aka Triple P, aka the Common Sense Podcast, your source for music, sports, politics, world events, and much, much more. My next guest that I'm about to bring you on is an absolute veteran of the bare knuckle fight world. He has a pro boxing record of 1-0, a BKFC record of 6-2-1. He's the number 3 featherweight and the number 5 ranked lightweight. Let's bring him in, Howard H.D. Davis. What's H.D., up? How you doing, man?
I'm good. You?
I'm great, man. I want to start here with a two-part question. What were you doing before bare knuckle, and how'd you get into bare knuckle?
What I was doing before bare knuckle? I was doing bare knuckle.
Okay.
I was just doing it without pay. I was doing it for the wrong reasons. It was the outlet for, you know, anger and, you know, certain things happen. You know, how I grew up, we wasn't taught to run and go get guns and, you know, knives. Like, we settle our issues with our hands. So my mom brought me up that way, my cousins and stuff like that. So it stuck with me throughout my whole life. And I think I've just been a natural born fighter, like, of just everything, of life, of just everything, man.
That's the good old days when it was all about your hands and not guns.
Yeah.
So,
golden era.
So how'd you get into doing it organized with BKFC?
I had a coach that he had a bridge to BKFC, and we had a fighter that was already like kind of prepped to do it, Jared K. Gotti, my ex-stable mate. And he started first. I was trying to go the pro boxing route, but it takes money and, you know, having support. And, you know, I didn't have that. I was a grown man already. I didn't have much amateur experience in boxing because I started late. So I took the bare knuckle route, and it's turned out pretty well for me. You know, I appreciate all the people that's helped me get this far. You know, BKFC as a organization, you know, Dave Feldman for giving me the opportunity, and I'm trying to be one of the best to ever do it.
Well, watching your highlights yesterday, you look like a natural boxer. You definitely do.
Yeah.
Now, you had to fight with Jimmy Rivera. I want to start there.
Yeah.
So I was watching the highlights again yesterday. Was that fight, do you think that fight was as close as they said it was as the results?
It definitely was close. And even Jimmy noticed, man. Jimmy talked about it. But I went into the fight messed up. Couldn't really use my dominant hand as I wanted to because I think it was like a few tears in it through the ligament and through the I had a few ruptures in the satchel bands. And I really wasn't supposed to fight that fight. But Jimmy being Jimmy and me being the up-and-comer in BKFC, an opportunity to fight a former UFC number one contender, I took the risk, you know, against the doctor's wishes and everything. And it sucked because Jimmy, I wanted to give Jimmy, like, everything I could inside that ring. Pause. But yeah, man, and I really couldn't, but he had really good timing. He had good punches. He was really heavy the night of the fight. And I can't take nothing away from Jimmy. Jimmy fought really, really good. I feel like he should beat Kai if he fights the right way. You know, if he fights Kai like how he fought me, he'll win. So, but Kai is a different type of fighter, how he comes in with his style and the grappling and the weird angles and the switching, you know. You got to give credit where credit's due. Like, he's won his fights with that type of style. So the fight with Jimmy, it was close. And it probably would have been close even if my hand was good, because Jimmy had, you know, the tools. Jimmy had the experience. Like, I fought Jimmy my third professional fight. Jimmy got, like, fucking 30 fights, bro. Jimmy, you know what I'm saying? Like, I was at a big disadvantage. Like, a lot of people had me getting knocked out, and don't get it wrong, like, Jimmy can hit. Like, he's probably hit me the hardest out of everybody, to be honest. He probably has hit me the hardest. So, it was a close fight regardless. Even with the injury, you know, I did drop him with the right hand, but it wasn't, like, how I really wanted to, like, hit him with the right hand. But, you know, it kind of sucked that, you know, sometimes us fighters, we go through camps and stuff, and injuries happen, and we don't want to let down the fans or the organization, so we go through the fight. And, you know, people may call it an excuse, but I actually got the paperwork of me getting, you know, the MRI and everything, because I kept getting x-rays. I thought I had a break or something, but yeah. I never got an MRI in my life. I finally got an MRI, like, probably a week and a half before the fight, 2 weeks, and my shit was all tore up, bro. And after the fight, my hand was like, it should look like my hand looked animated, bro. And it wasn't a regular like BKFC, your hands are swollen. Like my hand was like double, triple the size of how my hand looked. Like it was crazy, bro. And I had to get surgery right after that.
Well, seeing how some people have been quitting lately, I commend it. You know what I'm saying? If you're too injured to be fighting and you still fighting. Now, did you look at that, knowing that you were injured going to that fight and as close as it was, did you look at it more as a win or a loss?
My hand hasn't been 100, hasn't gotten back to 100% because I probably did that. If I'd have got the surgery rather than fought that fight, mm-hmm. maybe my hand would be a little bit closer to 100%, but because I fought on it and, you know, pushed the boundaries, I don't know. Longevity-wise, it probably wasn't the best thing because I didn't get the win. I got a draw. And then now I got to deal with my hand, not always, you know. So it's mm-hmm. like, I can't really say. Like, it was a greater experience to fight Jimmy. Like I said, he has accolades in the UFC and as a fighter overall. So, you know, it's good, I guess. But if I got the one, it would have been better. But because this is a draw, I can't really say that it was 100% worth it.
And even with the Louis Lopez, they called the fight earlier. I saw an interview where you were saying you really felt like you could have went longer in that fight. And I think that's another thing where you just got to come in because you see guys get in there and quit.
Yeah, man. It's a hard sport. Like my last fight, I fought Sean. Sean was 3-1. Sean got power. Sean hit me with a overhand right as I threw, a jab. He threw a counter, but he threw it. Like his overhand right was like, he was already shorter than me, but his overhand right was really an overhand right. Like, he ducked his head and just swung, and it hit me. And, like, that shit left a big gash on my eyebrow. And they didn't, you know, they looked at it, but it wasn't no, like, oh, we're going to stop the fight. It wasn't no, like, giving me a warning. Like, for the Louis Lopez fight, the cut was on my eyelid. It was bleeding. Mm-hmm. I was still fighting. Neither one of us knocked each other down. From the first round stats, I clearly landed more, threw more, was more active, so I won that round. And we got back to the corner, they cleaned up the blood and stopped everything. And out of nowhere, it's like, we come out second round, they say, oh, you know, total on, I'm ready. Like, I'm smiling. Like, we, you know, I dap his hand, I'm like, you know, good shit. You know, I just came off for like a 6-month layoff after the Jimmy fight from the surgery. So that's my first time coming back after an injury. So I'm, you know, get my feet wet again. So I'm ready. I'm like, okay, let's go. They call me over and they throw their hands up and I'm like, they ask me, you okay? I'm like, yo, I'm fine. They're like, and they still throw their hands. I'm like, bro, I've seen worse cuts in the same area, in different areas, and y'all let the fight go on. I see people meat hanging out their fucking face and they let the fight go on. I'm the number one contender, and then this is the time you guys choose to do this. And then right after that, he gets propelled to a title fight. Like, damn, bro. So that kind of just like, you know, my whole course of going to the title or having a title first got changed because of that shit, because of the Louis situation. You know, Louis didn't even have a good record. Louis came to BKFC, lost to Rusty Crowder, and then he won his next fight. So he was 1-1, and he beat me. He was 2-1, and he fights Kai for the belt. It's like, when I was number one and I was undefeated, there were no talks of the belt or it being a title fight. And as soon as some crazy shit happened, that Dave Feldman didn't even like the call, because that night the doctor was stopping a lot of fights early because shit, he didn't even like to call. And out of nowhere, boom, title fight. It was like, oh, man, like, it just sucked, bro. It sucked to see because I put in a lot of work and I fought everybody they put in front of me. I didn't choose. You know, I came in, I fought Rusty Crowder for my first fight. He had, like, fucking 7 fights. I have no experience. Like, I was fighting everybody. So it is what it is, though, bro.
Yeah, they could have let that go longer because when Ryan Reber was getting – the shit beat out of him, excuse my language. And my he came back to win. I mean, that almost, going back to watch it again, I still, knowing the results, I still felt like he was going to lose that match. Man, you know, knowing the results.
Reber got that heart. He let
got a crazy heart, yeah. Now, I was watching your highlights a lot yesterday. I noticed a lot of guys, they like the bum rush as soon as the bell starts. It doesn't seem like you do that too much. It seems like you're more of a smart, calculative fighter. Am I right to say that?
I try to be. The only fight that I wasn't like that, I can honestly say, was the Louis fight. The Louis fight, I came out way too aggressive. A lot of Louis punches, not Louis has crazy accuracy. Like, I was running into Louis punches. Like, I just wanted to fight Louis had been talking shit for like the past year or two, and like it just was so annoying. I had to block him, like, and I finally got the opportunity to fight him, but it just wasn't the right matchup. And my mindset and me coming off that injury, like I kind of, like I said, I've never come off an injury and had to fight professionally, so it was a lot to get used to, and I needed a round to get warmed up. So once I came in to his punches and be fighting, like, and you know, kudos to him. He was throwing a good jab, he was throwing his punches, but I literally got better defense than that. Like I was running into his punches, just trying to land my punches. Like, yeah, I felt your power. Yeah, it's not shit. Let me keep going. What happens? Boom, I get cut, and it just bullshit after that. You know, I can't control what a doctor does. So on my record, I have a TKO loss and I never touched the fucking mat. I never quit. I never, none of that. But because this doctor stoppage, because the doctor came in and intervened like I was fucking dying, even though I came out second round and the cut that was open wasn't bleeding. Cut, man, yeah. That I had that night, cleaned that shit up good. No blood was dropping from there. Like, my shit was just bleeding all over the ring nonstop. Like, it wasn't even that, bro. So it's like, we've seen dudes with whole bloody faces, whole outfits that's white turn red, and like, I get a cut and they like, oh no, he can't continue. So it was like, come on, man. You know,
even sucks, like, bro. Melanie Shaw and Britton Hart. I mean, her whole joint was swollen and bloody, two flying out, and they let that go the whole distance, which the female fights usually do go the distance.
Yeah.
You know,
I mean, I can give you an example. That same night we fought, Palomino and Tom Scholes fought. And I think eventually they stopped his fight too, but they gave him more rounds. Like, and his meat was hanging out his eye, bro. Like, you can see the cut and then the meat was hanging out. And it was almost in the same spot as mine, or exactly the same spot. But I guess because it was a title fight, it let it, like, continue. But it's like,
yeah.
And you can't be biased like that, bro. Like, come on, bro. Like, you could at least gave me another round. Y'all didn't even come to me and say, you know, yeah, we may stop this, or, you know, we're going to give you a warning. They just kept looking at it and say, hey, protect this more, or we're going to stop this next round. They didn't say none of that, bro. He come out second round, I'm like, okay, I'm feeling better now. I done felt this hit. Okay, I know I got to protect this. All right, let's go. As soon as I get ready, they get us on the line. And they actually said knuckle up, and then they called the time immediately and called me over. I said, oh, shit, bro. I said, oh, shit. But, hey, that's my fault, man. I was too head first. That's on me. I can only blame myself.
So you got the chance to fight Kai Stewart. I'm watching again last night. It seems like an exhausting match. I mean, Kai was just going at you nonstop, man.
It was.
What was that match like?
That match was very hard for me. Honestly, I went through a lot during that camp, during that time, last year in that time, and it probably wasn't the best time to fight Kai because, again, this shit sucks, bro. If you go back and look, each time I had a loss, I had a surgery right before that. Before I fought Louis, I had a surgery on the right hand. Before I fought Kai, I got a screw put in my hand because the fight before that, I knocked a dude out with uppercut and snapped the bone of my shit, and I was out the whole time. So it's like every time that I come and I don't look like myself, before that I have a surgery. So it probably wasn't the best route to, you know, fight for a belt right after coming out of surgery. But it was like either fight or maybe you may lose this title shot, or if you fight a warm-up fight to get your feet back wet and you end up losing to get hurt, we're going to move on from you. So I had those choices. It was like they kind of had me in like a, you know, a pinch, bro. And being me, I'm like, okay, fuck it. You know, everybody asked me how your hand feel. And, you know, regardless if it felt good or not, I just had to push through it and keep training. So I got some really good shape. And I was, you know, doing my thing. You know, I went all the way to Utah, up by Montana where he's at. High altitude, wasn't out there long enough. It was so much shit going on in that camp that I didn't do right because I didn't prepare right. You know, my team, it was their first time having a championship fight. I just got signed with a new management team. That was their first time having the fighter fly out in a different altitude, different state. So that's my first time fighting out of Florida. So it was a lot to take on in those moments to go and fight him. Like, so it was so much more before the fight and then to get in the fight. And this motherfucker's nonstop. You know, he's fighting. He's doing his thing, bro. He got his own style. He got dirty boxing. But, bro, I'm getting low blow. The ref's not calling no points. The Kai's literally not even throwing a punch, literally charging into me with his fucking head, hit me in my neck, and, like, juggernauts in the crowd going crazy. Everybody's like, you know, how is that legal? Like, it's not even fighting at that point. So it's like, it was a lot to get adjusted to, you know. But I guess that could have been his plan and his coach's plan, because they probably felt like, in my mind, I didn't want to break my hand again. And if I do, it'll be me trying to counter off a shot and him charging it with his head, and I can't see his fucking face. So I'm trying to line up the uppercut or counter right hand, but all I see is the top of your fucking head or your forehead. There's not much to really aim for and hit. So it was a good game plan if that was their game plan, because he don't usually fight people like that. Like, he just fought Brian, and he basically outboxed him. If you watch that fight, he didn't fight Brian the same way he fought me. If you'd have fought if he would have fought me that way and tried to box me, I would have fucked him up. But because he fought me how he fought me and kept it close and just kept ramming me, and that's what they wanted to see in Utah, I guess. Because even though he was doing that, I was fighting back in the clinch and throwing just as many punches as he was. And not too long ago, I posted the stats for that. They had Kai 42 or 45 for clinch strikes, and they had me 9 for 12. So he was at like 100% damn near, and I was high too. But it was like, if you watch that fight, he did not land that many fucking clean clinch strikes, bro. Like, it's all the times I'm spinning out, I'm breaking up, I'm throwing punches. I'm throwing punches as he's throwing, and I'm blocking a lot of shots. But it's like they were just, it was definitely Team Kai over there. I'm not gonna lie to you.
Yeah, what you're saying makes a lot of sense, because when El Gallo seems like his style was kind of like how Kai was fighting you. Like, he's just coming at you.
Yeah.
And he's got that, that right, that just when it lands, it's lights out and whatnot. And he doesn't seem like Kai. Even Kai was saying when I interviewed him that he wasn't really a boxer, that he's got that, it's really just that punching power and whatnot.
Gallo a dog. He got his own style.
He is. I like El Gallo.
Yeah. It's different from Kai. Kai got more of it's technical, it's dirty, but it's technical in its own sense. Gallo has his own style, and it's more of like, I'm just going to get your ass out of there regardless of how it looks. But it's not like overly sloppy. Like, he got some tech to it too, but like, Kai shit is like, you could tell him and his trainer like practice on how they was going to shoot like against me. It's like we almost had an MMA match, because the nigga was like,
I think that's the wrestling in him, right? Yeah, he's kind of bringing that wrestling.
Yeah, like, man, like, he's shooting. He was shooting for me, bro. Like, and I like, I'm not trying to like stop a takedown. I'm trying to line up a punch, and it's hard to line up a punch when all you can see is the top of a motherfucker and their forehead. Like, it is hard. People are like, why you didn't throw the uppercut? I'm like, I did, and when I did, one time it landed good. But I was like, after I was already exhausted and like, bro, like, it was so, like I said, I don't even want to talk about it. But Kai know what was going on during that camp, or he found out when he did, and he used it to his advantage, regardless if it was from people that lived by me in my city, ex-people that I used to be associated with. It was a very dirty game going on for them to like, okay, we can't beat him in the physical aspect and him being longer and taller. We're going to fuck his mind up and make him, we're going to kind of try to take the fight out of him before the fight. And they definitely succeeded. And that's one thing I hang my head on, because I had my family come out there. I trained really hard, bro. I trained really hard. Despite the injury I just had, I trained really hard through all of that shit. I was up there running in the mountains in the cold. I hate the fucking cold, bro. Like, I took all the risks, and they still played it dirty. But it's boxing, man. It's the fight game, I guess, There's no rules in it, as some people say, but I have honor. I'm not finna bring nobody family into it, nobody kids, nobody character, or any type of accusations that aren't clear and true. I'm not finna use that shit to I don't do that, bro. When you see I'm at the press conference, I'm saying little shit about him. I'm not bringing his girl into it. His girl was there. I'm not bringing his mom into it. I'm not that type of guy. I mean, everybody ain't like me though, so I can't expect everybody to be me. But I was definitely shocked by the actions that happened before the fight, and right during the fight before it happened. Like, I didn't expect that from Kai, even though he has already done that with Louis Lopez, if you go back and look. So you kind of have a track record of doing little shiesty stuff like that. Yeah. But with me, it was totally false, and it was sick how like people was coming at me and my life and my family and like just doing a lot. And I just try to give it to God and stay focused, bro. Like, but it was definitely hard.
Nah, I noticed you're definitely sportsman. You got sportsmanship. Even when you take the low blows, the cheap hits, I always see you shaking hands. You're very sportsmanlike. What's the rumblings about the Jake Paul beating Mike Perry, man, in the BKFC? Like, Connor posted that thing. I know I said I felt like BKFC would be upset that he lost, but then I didn't expect Connor to post that. Like, is there any validity to that, you think?
I don't know. I don't. Hopefully not. You know, I mean, I know I just found out by looking into that, that Mike Perry is creating his own fighting promotion.
Oh, that's so that's what it's more about.
Yeah, I guess.
That's what it's more about.
Yeah, so yeah. He's creating his dirty boxing thing. And I guess, I don't know if BKFC doesn't like it or just Connor doesn't like it. And it's kind of like trickling down in that aspect. Like, okay, now you lost on our, you know, now you lost with our face or being our face on top of, you know, now you creating a promotion. So maybe they feel a way about it, you know. I mean, but yeah. Mike just trying to, Mike doing what he's doing. He's trying to get his money for his family, man. Like, this fighting shit don't last forever. You know, Mike is the youngest. But he, you know, he takes a lot of damage. He fights. He entertains the fans. So
he does. Yep.
You know, they like he's the king of violence for a reason. Regardless of they want to say Jake Paul is now like, nah, you know, they went and fought. They went and fought. Yeah, they went and fought a boxing match. Like Jake boxes. That's what he's been doing.
Yeah.
Like, Mike is, you know, UFC, a little boxing background, and then bare knuckle. Like it's different. Like people don't understand the difference it is from boxing and bare knuckle. Like I just did the team combat league, bro, and it's a difference when you're and those smaller gloves and how you turn over your punches and how the power feels and how it is totally different. Like a lot of bare knuckle people won't make it in boxing and a lot of boxers won't make it in bare knuckle. So that's why it's two different lanes for a reason. But Mike didn't do bad, man. It just, you know, he just lost to a better guy that night.
Yeah.
That's it.
I said I thought he wouldn't be the face no more. And I do know from inside sources that BKFC, when you go outside of the sport, they don't like for you to lose.
Oh no!
They hate that. They when you come back, you like low man on the totem pole once you come back because you done went over here and got beat, and they don't. I know they don't like that, you know. Because I used to produce all the Circle of Kings content before we had a kind of falling out. But shouts out the Knuckletown official and Big Face doing their thing. But you know, I knew Josh Chassie, and he would give us a lot of insights of what the rumblings would be. So and then. Of course, I interviewed Redneck Mandel, and he—I know he's pissed. He's pissed off because he wanted Mike Perry before this.
Yeah, he wanted
not
him
after.
He wanted Mike forever,
and now I know partially is because Mike Perry beat Redneck back in the days in the MMA, and I know.
I don't think I even know that.
I was doing some research. They fought back in the MMA back in the days. Uh-huh. I forgot to ask Redneck about it, but I know that's partially the reason why Redneck wants to get his hands on him because Mike Perry won that MMA fight back in the days. And plus, Mike Perry being the face and you don't got a belt. That's another thing I ain't gonna lie, I do have an issue with that. But that's another topic for another day.
You know how it is though, man. It's all about what sells, you know. Mike Perry
known
worldwide. He's a great guy.
Yeah,
personality, he's a dog. So you know you want to push that agenda and get the fans going and people come out for Mike, bro. Mike get on the card,
they do
gonna, like damn near sell out. You know how it is, bro. But it's business, you know, it's fighting, you know, it's the best fighters. Like Mike got an undefeated record in BKFC, so it's not like he's like losing and they're doing it. You know, it's not a bad move, but I definitely get it. I get it to an extent.
I got a couple more questions, and then we're gonna let you go.
All
right. Shaq like one of your sponsors still?
Yeah, Shaq is sponsoring me for my up and coming fight September 13th at the Hard Rock.
How'd that opportunity come about where Shaq became a sponsor?
No, it's just crazy. Like, I've always been a diehard Lakers fan, bro. Like, that's the only reason I probably like basketball. I watch basketball. It's Kobe and Shaq, bro. So, to have him sponsor me and it to be random, like, yo, it just happened on Instagram one day. Like, nobody connected me. Nobody, nothing, bro. I just, like, reached out to him one day and, like, I think I tagged him in a video and, like, he reposted. I'm like, oh, shit. Like,
oh, man.
Yo, Shaq reposted the video and then, like, you know, it started happening a few more times, and I don't even say anything here. We posted our, we'll just be talking about little things. Like, I've had conversations and everything. Like, I literally have, like, Shaq's number. Like, I can call him, bro. So, it was like, we just was, like, talking, and, like, I'm telling him, like, oh, yeah. And I never, like, asked anybody for money, bro, especially not a person of that stature and the person that gives back, like, how he gives back. So, yeah, even though I know he can do it, I just said, you know, if you got any sponsors or people that you can, you know, reach my name out to and get me some, you know, sponsorships or like help me get some basically in a sense. And he's just like, oh, how much is the sponsorship? And I told him, and he just sent the money and, you know, he sponsored me. And I was like, I couldn't believe it because it happened at such like at a random time and a time that I needed it. And it was just like, that's God, bro, just aligning me with the people that need to be aligned with me and me, you know, being next and close to somebody that great, somebody I idolize, you know, because like that's Shaquille O'Neal, bro. Like that's Shaq.
Everybody loves Shaq.
Yeah, because he's a great person. Like
great human being.
Yeah, I literally see him just do stuff out the kindness of his heart. And it's like, that's why when I did tell him about sponsorship, I didn't ask him for anything. I didn't ask him, you know, directly. I said, can you know, put my name in some rooms and see if some people want to get their brand out there, want to sponsor a fighter. And he took it upon himself to do it. And that was big, bro. Like I said, all blessings to God. I can't make up.
And he's a great businessman. It makes sense, I think, for Shaq, too, because BKFC blowing up like it is.
Yeah.
He's a businessman. I mean, every commercial he does, he's invested into those companies.
Yeah.
So smart. He's truly, truly smart. Next fight. Who's your next fight?
I'm going to be in that Dancing with the Legendary James Brown.
That's who you're fighting, James Brown?
Yeah.
And when is that?
It's going to be September 13th.
September 13th. And where is that? Let me pull up the website. They already got that on the website.
It's gonna be the Hard Rock Casino.
Oh, Hard Rock Casino again? Oh man, that is the go-to spot for BKFC fights, for what I'm seeing.
Yeah, that shit is definitely lit.
Is that gonna be on the Reber and the Redneck?
Yes, sir.
Card. Oh man, that's gonna be another stacked card, man. It seems like all those cards are super stacked.
Oh, for sure, for sure.
Yep. Well, before we let you go, anything you want to shout out?
Shout out to God first, man, for waking me up this morning, for waking you up, waking everybody
appreciate
up.
It.
You know, big blessings to everybody that support me, that support fighters, that support anybody that's chasing the dream. And, you know, everybody just keep doing what you're doing. Just stay on a positive path, you know, help each other out, show love rather than hate. And shout out to all my sponsors, Shaq, Giazos, Abe, Alon Spine, All In, Demesman and Dover. I got so many more. Prime IV, Forever Young IV, Inkaholic. They be running. I hate when I do sponsorship shout outs because it's like it's so many, bro. Like if I forgot any and you were watching this, don't get mad at me. Just hit me up and say, "Hey, G, say us next time." Oh, got a new sponsorship. Fast food restaurant. I don't think I can consider it fast food because you can sit down and eat there and it's amazing. It's better than fast food. Savvy Sliders, located in Broward County, Florida, on Commercial. One of the best food places. One of my favorite. You guys tap in there, you know. Appreciate them for the sponsor. Appreciate you for the time, bro. Thank you so much.
All right, man. I appreciate you for doing the interview. As soon as I get off here, I'm going to start clipping up some clips, man. You know I support anything you posting and doing, man.
Hey, I appreciate you, bro. Thank you, bro. God bless.
You too. You have a nice day, man.
You too, bro. Thank you.
All right. Peace. All right. Well, there it is. HD Davis. He'll be fighting James Brown September 13th at the Seminole Hard Rock Casino and Cafe, Hollywood, Florida. Of course, you got Reber versus Blas. You got Redneck versus King Mo. It's going to be another stack card as usual, and it's going to be sold out as usual. And once again, thank you for tuning in to another episode of the Paul Pickett Podcast, and I'm out. Peace.